have in this country is far more powerful than even the laws and the law enforcing structures. Justice must be for all and not.
Uganda is now a law factory, okay? And MPs are, you know, manufacturing line. That for any problem that we have, it's pass a law, pass a law.
No matter what happens, we still need this law.
I may speak a word in my own language, which is offensive in your own language. Not so. All of you know this. I'm not going to do this. Now, how are you going to judge that my word is pornographic and yours is not?
You think there is good, you feel kneeling, and as you kneel in churches, you come out like that, qualified lunatics, you fools, stupid, as you go to church.
To work with the red paper. And
I take this opportunity to recognize the presence of Mr. Kato Mukasa, the chair for African Working Group, a hero and executive director, open talk debate. Please, last but not least, I take the opportunity to introduce to you Mr. Solomon Male, a renowned city pastor, an advocate. Actually, let me introduce to you Councilor Nicholas Opio. Councilor Nicholas Opio CV is a political and social analyst and a lawyer. Let me introduce the topic of tonight. The topic simply goes, Africa needs stronger laws to safeguard its roots and cultures. I will begin my night's discussion, ladies and gentlemen, with a lawyer who is also heading an NGO, Open Talk Debate, and her lawyer, Mr. Kato Mukasa.
Thank you very much. The chairperson of the day. Thank you very much, the main discussants and the audience. And I believe that many others on their way are coming. Now, when we're organizing this debate, we looked at the bigger picture and we narrowed it down to the laws. And actually, what I was telling the moderator was that we wanted to talk about the pornography law in this country, but also look at the wider picture of Africa and the cultures and the norms. So the moderator, we are trying to put it back into perspective so that all of us can benefit in this discourse. Now, my case today is going to be centered more on the anti-pornography law, and my presentation is that the law, even when most of us have heard that it is protecting our morals and culture, to me, I'm still saying it is against the fundamental rights of all of us. Now, I want to bring to you a brief background of this law, the Anti-Pornography Act, which I have here, very, very short, very, very brief law, which all of you can access, a few pages and read through, and then try to analyze this law in line with the topic and then find out whether we need such laws in this country, whether it's really important to safeguard our norms and cultures using such law. Now, briefly speaking, the said law, the anti-pornography law, was tabled in Parliament in 2011 and passed on the 19th December of 2013 and then signed into law by our President on the 6th February 2014. Now, effective on 9th May 2014, it was gazetted in the Uganda Gazette and therefore became law. Now, most of you have heard this law being said or being called the miniskirt law. The anti-pornography bill, as earlier was, had revelations to the effect that it was talking about pornography in a way as display of sexual parts of a person, such as breasts, thighs, buttocks, genitalia, etc., etc. And now, because of the bill, people began looking at the law which we have today in the light of the previous bill. Yet, at the end of the day, the law we have here today is slightly different from the bill as we had it earlier on. Now, it's no longer actually talking about miniskirts. It's no longer talking about sexual parts in the way it was discussed in the bill. It is more talking about, it is describing pornography in a different way. But still, because of the literal treatment and publicity from our media and all that, people still believe that this law is all about the miniskirts. Now, we thought, as a layer, when we were organizing this debate with Andrew Lumba here, that we should bring the true picture of the law, then we discuss its merit and demerits, then we look at the bigger picture of Africa, which I know my colleagues will give justice to. Now, when you talk about culture, as the topic goes, and the norms, my question is, what type of culture are we talking about here today? What type of African culture are we talking about here? Therefore, that you should be able to preserve, so that such laws are very much needed. Sometimes I want to ask whether it is within African culture to say that women must be our subordinates, to say that we must direct women on how to wear, how long a skirt should be, whether it's part of our culture to make women look inferior, to make them have a low self-esteem, and all that. Is it part of African culture? Because you're going to come and say, culture, culture, culture. What is it that is part of the African culture that you want to preserve, that therefore we need such that dictate how people are going to dress, among others? Now, what's so particular about this African culture? I'm reminding you about some of our tribes where actually dressing the way we dress today is not part of their culture. Some people simply dress and cover the private parts and then they move. We all know that. So when you're talking about African culture preservation, what type of culture are you talking about in terms of dressing? Is it the culture of going nude or wearing the so-called long dresses? And who determines that? Is it the man or the women themselves? So, then I want to ask before I go into this kind of business of culture and all that, when you begin talking about civilization, talking about culture and norms, is it part of African culture that men are not tolerant? That men cannot simply respect the other opposite sex without wanting to go into bed with them? Because that time I was listening to the Minister of Ethics saying, even the Minister of Youth, Kibule, one day was quoted saying that all women who are putting on miniskirts should be what?
Raped.
And I was disturbed. You think men are like animals? That whenever you see a woman putting on a short thing, therefore you get enticed and then you run into having sex with that person. So I thought that we had moved beyond that as men, at least being civilized. And I'm beginning wondering, why do we need such laws in the guise of protecting morals and culture? And my question remains, what culture, what morals are you protecting when you bring about such laws, which to me are very sensitive? When you look at the Anti Pornography Act, it defines pornography not as the bill had defined it, but as any representation through publication, exhibition, cinematography, indecent show, and I'm putting it in capital letters here, indecent show. What is an indecent show? If we had a show in this hall, what qualifies the show to be indecent? Information technology, or by whatever means of a person engaged in a real or stimulated explicit sexual activities, or any representation of the sexual parts of a person for primarily sexual excitement. We are looking at the law. When I talk about primarily sexual excitement, what do you mean in this law? That if someone puts on something, that someone is, say, using a computer, or there is a show going on, and somehow it is intended to primarily excite someone sexually, to me, I don't understand that, because I begin asking questions. What type of excitement is that, and how can it drive that using this definition? The law again talks about a person shall not produce, traffic in, publish, broadcast, procure, import, export, sell, abet any form of pornography, etc., etc. And the sanctions are very tough there. It also talks about Pornography Control Committee, which I still have a problem with. Pornography Control Committee, where we are going to have a police monitoring our behaviors, a police monitoring how we watch our movies, whether at home or in public cafes, whatever, how we use our internet, how we watch the shows, theaters, and all that stuff, how we do performances. Halea, why we are interested in this debate is partly because we work with young people and we produce movies, we produce music, we produce plays. Sometimes we want to talk about issues affecting young people, like rape, issues affecting other people like defilement, and all that. Now, how are we going to have a play if you want to depict sexual harassment without trying to bring out a picture, say, by someone putting on something and all being roughed and all that stuff? I mean, how do we do this when you have a law which says, among others, that you must get permission from the minister or from the committee to stage anything that can be pornographic, that can show some of these vices in society? Now, when you look at this law, it affects people dealing with computers. Actually, my point was, don't think that this law is all about miniskirts now. It's beyond that. It talks about people dealing with computers, people having cafes, the so-called internet service providers. It talks about telephone operators. It talks about people operating leisure and entertainment halls, like this hotel is affected by this law. It talks about bookshop owners. It talks about dealers in photography, newsprint, media. You work with red paper. And I can put it to you that red paper is number one in giving us the pictures you want to watch of women who are almost putting on the way they want. And some of us want the pictures anyway, but they are saying you'll be in trouble. Actually, the law is already signed. You must be in trouble. Because that is print, newsprint, or magazine, or a vendor, importer, exporter, etc. So the law is beyond. It looks at people in all these areas, including a broadcaster, someone working on a radio station and talking about sex, for example. And the question is, how are you going to determine whether my word is causing an excitement or not? Because that's the definition of pornography. Now, it also talks about forfeiture and destruction of pornographic materials. Like, if the police is convinced and the courts of law are convinced that you have a pornographic material, they are going to come and get this material and then destroy it. So, that one you should know that it's no longer about the dressing only, but also other areas that all of you must get concerned and say, no, we must find a way of handling this law. Now, it talks about the authorization, as I said, that the committee must allow you to stage anything which they call pornographic. And as I say here, that pornography here is not properly defined. It's very vague. When you look at the definition, what is pornographic and what is not very clear. Because how do you determine my words that they are pornographic? According to which culture? All of us have different cultures here. I may speak a word in my own language, which is offensive in your own language. Not so. All of you know this. I'm not going into this. Now, how are you going to judge that my word is pornographic and yours is not? If you are going to judge me using the words I'm going to speak. Because our language is rich, but with different meanings. Now, if you look at this, the law itself in definition of pornography is very, very vague and must be revisited, and therefore we must have the best way of defining this. For example, when it was being passed, the former prime minister, that is Amama Mbabazi, actually complained that the law itself was what? Was vague. And he was also saying the way they are defining pornography and all that is not clear. It is on record was saying, let us go and have this ambiguity resolved, but it was never resolved. So it's very, very hard to understand what is pornographic using this law and what is not pornographic. Now, for example, even when they are no longer talking about the miniskirts, for example, how do we judge what is too short and what is enough? Are we saying that a dress must be above the knee or below the knee? And who determines what is good for me to dress if I was a lady and what is not good for me? For example, why doesn't this law talk about men? Why is it sexist?
does it concentrate on women? Yet we have also seen men who wear the way they want. If you want to control, assuming it was good to control all this kind of stuff, why do you target women? And then you say, we are a country where we respect everyone is what? Rights. So I thought that was not good. Now look at the sweeping powers of the committee. The committee has so many powers. I call them sweeping powers because they can simply come and arrest you, clamp your organization down. Like they say, you have pornographic material, you were about to show something pornographic. The committee will come and, you know, shut you down. Look what the way you have to say.
Mr. Kato, I just wanted to, yes. to ask you yes. really a very pertinent issue.
Yes.
Isn't there generally, from really the bottom of your heart,
yes.
isn't there a general view that there are certain things that Africans must not engage themselves, especially going to the extreme? If you talk about something about putting on dressing, uh-huh. dressing, in the world of Africa, isn't there something that tells your brains that you're not supposed to put on a cloth of a lady that is below your knees?
You want to tell me that before this law, people didn't know what to put on and had to know what to put on and what not to put on? Do you need a lot to know?
Don't we really need guidance?
Which guidance?
On how we should put on?
Which guidance?
I'm just asking.
Yes.
Should we leave you to put on what you want to put on?
Yes.
Without any guidance?
Yes. Why do you need to legislate about the way you dress? Why? How well have you been before? Because we haven't been having such
Yes, you can raise your point of
view. Let me finish. I think, Chairman.
I would like to inform the African speaker that we shouldn't forget about culture. Culture itself, it has laws that we're supposed to put into consideration. So without laws, nothing can go ahead because we have to do with governance. So when you talk about that we don't have to be with laws to govern us on our way out, put on, then we shall put aside culture.
What role governs you how you put on? You are a man. Do I know that governs how you put on?
Yeah, I'm a Muganda, and as my culture, I'm not supposed to move naked, yes. like the Maasai's. That's a law.
So,
okay, let's move on. Thank you so much.
So far, through this law, and other laws like the Anti Pornography Law and others, some organizations were the foreign victim of these unfair laws. For example, I was coming here and I showed people where the Water Health Clinic is, the project, which was closed.
Yeah.
Water Reed was closed because they were saying they were dealing with pornography material. So even NGOs.
Did you look into when they were coming to Uganda, did you look into the agreement what they had come to do? Was it about pornography?
No.
If they were found to be showing pornography, did you look into their commitments when they were coming here?
The point I'm making here is...
Yes. No, you are feeling sympathetic about the
yes.
closed. Yes, we can all feel it, but did you realize what they come to do and what they are doing?
The point I'm making here, and you should be sober if you are going to listen and get my views. The point I'm making here is that some NGOs already are fallen victims of this blackmail. They will come...
Blackmail?
Yes, they will come and allege that we have pornographic material without even any iota of evidence, and they will cramp you down for like 6 months. Now they are down until they investigate. By the time they open the organization, you're already not in function. Now, if you look at, let me give you other examples, because I don't disturb them actually with all those questions. Now, let me give you more examples. There are these lawyers. There are examples where some lawyers have been stopped from practicing. You law students, you should know this. From practicing, because someone says they have dressed indecently. There is this case of a lawyer called Lillian Drabo. Drabo was arrested by a female prison officer as she entered Nakawa Court. And her offense was dressing in a dress she said was enough, was fair enough, because she was actually using it before the coming of the law. But she was arrested for over, 4 hours, and even failed to go and represent the client. There was another lady, journalist like you, called Patience Akumu. Akumu was going to seek permission from police to have a demonstration against this law. She was also arrested for dressing indecently. And the question was, what is decent? What is indecent? So,
yes.
When you look at this, I have some questions as I wind up here. Which I want to think about. For example, we won't have all these laws and you are going to come and talk about your morals and culture and all that stuff. My question is, why do you have laws, Irumba, which are not practical? Why do you talk about computer cafes, internet service providers, and you are saying that if you are going to provide internet services, you must know what your client, effectively, what your client is watching? Is it possible in this world of ours, look at our Kampala here, a computer provider to understand what I am doing on my PC? In other words, won't it be an infringement on my own right if someone is going to come and say, what are you watching? What are you checking? Isn't it pornography? Because if you don't do that, anyway, you will be arrested. Now, look at what determines what is fake and what is right. For example, we all heard about the vagina monologues, not so. Remember that? About 2 years ago. The vagina monologue was a play written by a British, if I don't forget, a lady, and it was about rights of women. But because the word was vagina, the Minister of Ethics and many others stopped the play to be broadcasted without actually even watching it.
No, the moment you say V monologue.
You know the V monologue?
That's obscene enough.
Now, and that's the problem. Mr. Kato. That's the problem I have with you, because
the moment you say V.
Now, do you hate the word vagina? Don't know that a woman has a vagina and you have a penis. What's wrong with that? Why don't you
say that? You're repeating obscene words.
No, because that's the problem we have with this law. Now, for example, as I wonder, look at people who are owning hotels like this, and you are going to have a show here, and you are saying if the hotel owner doesn't censor, in effect, doesn't know what's going to be shown, and something happens, like a show is pornographic, assuming, the owner of that hotel or theater is going to be arrested and punished. And actually, if it's a company, it's certainly going to be cancelled. Now, look at that. Are you saying that the owner of the hotel is going to, first of all, watch the play and see whether it has pornography or not before it is broadcast? Are you getting my point? It's vague. How are you going to maintain this? Yeah, so, finally, as a way forward, let me give this way forward in 2 minutes. Now, one, I want to call on the stakeholders here that we do two things. One, we amend the law if you really need it, or we squash it. Squash it or amend it. Because after all, it violates all our rights. Right to privacy, the rights of freedoms and all that stuff. Now, secondly, I want to urge you, government and the media, Andrew Irumba and all those guys who work on the radios, to try to sensitize people that the anti-pornography law is not about indecent dressing. It's no longer the miniskirt law. It cuts across a number of issues. And the women should be respected. We should stop undressing them because, after all, the law is vague and uncalled for. Lastly, I want to request that it must be a primary responsibility of all of us here to, with due respect, respect the rights of others as you want to be respected. If you're a man and you want to dress the way you want,
in other words, don't walk naked because you're offending someone.
Whatever you want to say, but my point is, let us respect the rights of women, let us respect the rights of companies and businesses, let us respect the rights of proprietors of businesses, as people who must be given the due authority, the due respect to do their business without any of these encumbrances. After all, as I conclude, your law is very vague and must be contested, must be amended or quashed.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kato Mukasa. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Mr. Kato Mukasa, chairman, and we have organized this event in partnership with them. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce to you a man who is a charismatic human rights defender, who has defended civil liberties at many avenues in Uganda, defended civil society actors in social courts of law, defended the pro-democracy activists in courts both in Uganda and for the East African Court of Justice. Ladies and gentlemen, on the floor, let me have Counsel Nicholas Otillo.
First, that instead of focusing on the law, much less on the law on pornography, African societies are better served focusing on defining what African values are exactly. To me, that should be the premise. What is African? In this global village, can we have something as a pure African value? We must dedicate our effort and time in defining what are those roots, what are those values we call African values. Because if we cannot define ourselves in this global village of ideas and values, we shall get lost and have our identity submerged by other powerful identities. The second point that I want to make is Africans cry victims all the time. Whether it is the president, whether it is ordinary Ugandans, lawyers, or judges, we want to cry the victim. We are a victim of colonialism. Today, today Zambia marks 50 years as an independent African country. But they are still crying about the evils of colonialism. We are playing victim, not just in the spheres, legal spheres, but even in the spheres of value identity. Africans cry victim. My suggestion would be, instead of crying the victim, that we are a victim of Western culture, we must look at Western cultures as competing cultures, okay, as competing cultures, and therefore seek to outdo what we think is bad about Western cultures. The third point that I want to make is really what I think should be a paradigm shift in our thinking as Africans. And I'll give you two examples. And then one example really comes from my village. You know, there was a young boy who came to Kampala because of the war. We brought him here to study. Now, when he went to school, he wasn't performing very well. And so when we asked him, he said, "But what is the problem?" He said, "But you see, I'm from a war zone." Okay? He was saying, "I'm from the north, from a war zone." We should, I think in my own view, disabuse ourselves from what I think is a disease called excusitism. We have excuses for everything. We must begin to define what African ideologies are and project those ideologies in the market value, in the marketplace of ideas. But on the specific topic today, let me make the following point. First, Uganda is now a law factory, okay? And MPs are, you know, manufacturing line. That for any problem that we have, say, pass a law, pass a law, pass a law. Whether it is tobacco, pass a law. Pass
so
a law.
You have called it the what?
It's a law factory. Everything, pass a law. Let's pass a law. But laws in themselves must be geared towards addressing a mischief. But be that as it may, laws in themselves are no solutions to social problems. No matter how many laws you pass, they will not change your culture. They will not direct the behavior of individuals. Because if laws were the solution to problems, perhaps nobody would be killing today. But we still kill in spite of the fact that there is law against killing. So we must first of all define that mischief. In the Anti Pornography Act, I failed to define the mischief that the law intended to address. Was there so much an outbreak of quote unquote pornography that justified then Parliament sitting and debating this as a serious national matter? What was the mischief that Parliament sought to address? In my own view, there was no mischief. Rather, it was merely a continuation. What I think is now a trend, the moralization of legislation in Uganda. That's because Pastor Malay preaches against indecent exposures, we therefore must legislate against indecent exposures. The state is captive to the agenda of moralists and people who think of this society as a monolithic society, society of one value. My own sense is that Uganda is not a society of one value. There cannot be something called a Ugandan culture because there are over 62 tribes,
there are differences between tribal practices and values, but even within those tribes, there are also differences. So nothing is uniform. So we cannot therefore begin to argue that it was protecting African values or societal values, because those values don't exist. If they existed, we'd have 62 different laws about different cultures and practices. Secondly, let me argue that the Anti-Pornography Act is not about pornography, because 98% of the law is not about pornography. It is about many other things, and I can name them for you. First, internet freedom, okay, the power of the new media. Secondly, it's about press freedoms and the right to express yourselves. That is what this law is about. It's not about some girl wearing a V-neck top with her bust out. No, it is not. This law is about these particular freedoms, and this is why I think this law is dangerous. First, the law defines pornography. Initially, it was about, you know, the length of your skirt, the manner of your dress. But finally, the act that was passed defines pornography, and I can read this word for word because I think it is important. Pay close attention to it. Pornography means any representation through publication, exhibition, cinematography, indecent show, information technology, or by whatever means of a person engaged in real action, or stimulated explicit sexual activities, or any representation of the sexual parts of a person for primarily sexual excitement. First, this definition makes the assumption that sexual excitement is a bad thing, that you should just go and mount like a goat. Okay? Sexual excitement isn't a bad thing. In fact, it's a useful thing in courtship. Because if I am not sexually attracted to you, I would argue that I would not conceive the idea of courting you. Secondly, and perhaps even more importantly, talks about sexual parts. What are sexual parts? Okay? What are sexual parts? Please help me define sexual parts. Okay, what are sexual parts? Is it just the male and female genitalia? In the world where I live, I don't know which world you live in, even the hand can be a sexual organ. Even the mouth can be a sexual organ. This law doesn't define sexual organs. So those of you who like to rubber dub, young people call it rubber dub, to gyrate in a, you know, in a dance hall, that becomes a crime. Becomes pornographic. In my own culture, there's a dance called Raka Raka, where we all calabash a few things and we drop. That is a courtship dance. In fact, in that dance, a woman must show how soft her waist is to a man, to impress a man to identify a partner. The Raka Raka dance would become unlawful under this act, because they are expressions of sexual nature that entices sexual feelings. But also more importantly, it doesn't matter whether it is about you, the person who is performing that act. It doesn't matter. You may not have the mental intention, what lawyers call mens rea, yeah, to cause sexual excitement. It is about how the other person feels. Okay? I may just be doing my thing, not seeking to excite Mr. Rumba. God forbid I don't excite him. He can be vicious. It doesn't matter whether I intended to do that, but rather what Mr. Irumba feels about my actions. That is the danger. That once you begin to legislate, not on the basis of a mens rea or a mental intention to commit a crime, but rather about how the other person feels, you have a very dangerous legislation. A very, very dangerous legislation. Thirdly, let me make this point, that this law is a sexist law. Perhaps it is reflective of the mindset of our leaders. And perhaps let me just go back and quote what she said was uttered by the president a couple of days ago. The media reports indicated that at a very heated neck meeting, President Museveni asked his former prime minister, which African man cannot control his wife? I thought that women rights activists would be mad at this statement. Surprisingly, they are very quiet. But that exactly is the spirit under which this law is enacted. It's a sexist law that seeks first to promote a sexist agenda of people who look at this society as an homogeneous society, is a particular manner of dressing that must be promoted. Firstly, the law creates a moral police. And be afraid if you don't know what a moral police is. Be very afraid, because this has happened, I mean, elsewhere. I'll give you an example. In a country called Saudi Arabia, they have a committee called the Mutawins. The Mutawins are a committee under their law described as the committee for the prevention of vice and the promotion of virtues. And you've got to look at the functions of that committee to see how dangerous that committee is. That committee has powers to expedite the development or acquisition and installation of effective protective software in electronic equipment such as computers, your laptops, mobile phones that you're holding, and television for the detection and suppression of pornography. So you're moving into an era in which what you see on your Facebook page, on your tablet, can become a subject of criminal prosecutions against you. Even if you're not the one who has produced it, you will install a software or equipment in your phone. They would require internet service providers or IPS providers to not only monitor, but install equipment on your gadgets. Okay? That's how dangerous it is. And that committee can prosecute you for what is termed as pornography under the law. In my own view, and this might be surprising to many of you, I don't think the law, which is where I earn my living, or indeed religion, where my good friend Pastor Male earns his living, is a panacea for addressing what I think are societal problems or social problems. Because religion in itself is un-African. At least the Christian sense that we know it. The white Jesus, blue-eyed, blonde Jesus on the cross, is not African. I haven't seen a black Jesus on the cross. The idea of African religion has now been replaced by what Pastor Male preaches every single Sunday, every single day. So if you're looking for African values, you don't look for it in religion, much less in the law. You don't look for that African value and virtue in a judge wearing horse hair on his head as a wig, or in a lawyer wearing some black ugly gown going to court. You do not look for African values in those places. African values and cultures reside in the hearts and minds of the African people, who I challenge today to find it in their hearts and in their time to locate those African values. Because it is a global village. Each time I travel, I hear Chinese speaking Chinese, and there's a translator at the UN. There's a Russian speaking Russian. They have a Russian value. What value? What African language is, for example, spoken at the UN? So you're lost in this sea of identities and sea of values. You must look for that value, and those values reside in the heart and mind of the African people. No single law, no single religion can reinstall those values or those virtues. In fact, we must go back and begin to look at the African sense, perhaps in the world that Mr. Irumba lives in, where we look at, and this is why I admire the Asians. The Asian society in some places are still purist societies. The Dalai Lama, for example, lives in a world where it was clear what their values are. African societies must become those societies if they are to compete in the global village that we live in today. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nicholas O'Keefe. Let me invite Mr. Solomon Moses Malay. Mr. Solomon Moses Malay is the director of a Raising for Christ. He's an outspoken critic of corruption in churches, especially those that promote prosperity theology, which he calls the gospel of extortion.
I feel so saddened that at such a time I'm invited to talk about the anti-pornography law. I've rephrased the topic. Can tough anti-pornography laws safeguard Africa's norms and cultures? It's unfortunate that Ugandans are obsessed by laws. We make a law, we make a law, we make a law, we make a law, as if laws are going to solve the problem. The truth is that pornography is a challenge, especially to the young generation. Men have been compelled into premarital sexual activity, both heterosexual and homosexual, and consequences have been tragic. Why? Because of what they see and because of what they hear. It's part of the greater challenge we have and we face as a nation and as a continent because of declining moral values. In Uganda, the Anti-Pornography Act was passed in 2013 and assented to by the president in the hope that it will address the moral challenge that we have. I made this presentation time back on the 27th of April 2013, challenging the Minister of Ethics that we didn't need another law because we have very good laws on the penal code already. But they are all dead, they are not working. My brother Nicholas Opio is part of the justice system. He knows how corrupt and stinking rotten it is, that it cannot even implement and enforce the tough laws that we have, including laws against murder, laws against human trafficking, laws against human sacrifice. And unfortunately, our MPs, who are jobbers, continue manufacturing laws, one law after another. If I had the power, if you can empower me, if I became the president of tomorrow, I think I would become a dictator. Disband the parliament because it's a totally useless institution in this country. Because it thinks you make one law after another, without cleaning up the systems that are supposed to enforce the law and ensure justice and redress. I don't believe in laws anymore from what I've seen. You know, I'm a victim of the justice system just because I tried to do right, helping victims of sexual abuse and exploitation in this country. Now, to understand whether laws can help our continent and our country to achieve the purpose, and whether they are necessary, we need to understand some concepts. And one of the concepts is what we call a moral value. The second is what we call conscience. And the third is the Spirit of God and laws, which are so important in determining human decisions and behavior. Those four: moral values, two, the conscience, three, the spirit within a man of God, and four, the laws, are very important in determining human behavior. What are moral values? Moral values are a set of emotional rules people follow to help them make the right decisions in life. They are determined and rooted deep within a person's conscience. They are cherished ideas, thoughts, beliefs, or dreams of what is right and what is wrong, and what is important and what is not in human life. Are we together? I want you to understand this clearly so that you can tell whether any law is going to sort the problem or not.
Now, I don't believe in just what he talked about, the judiciary, or because of what he named it as rotting and kind of bogus way how he called it, as about judiciary. What I would like to correct him is about, at least we've tried to see, among the organs of the government, judiciary has tried to do its best, honestly.
Okay. In my opinion, judiciary has done its part.
Yes, it has done some.
Okay, he has a different view. But let's go ahead. Yes,
something will allow you to.
I pray, when conscience is alive of a person, you're talking about being Africans, is your conscience alive as an African? Is your conscience alive as a Ugandan? Is your conscience alive as a human being? Listen, when the conscience is alive, when a conscience is alive, a person feels shame and compelled to do good and right because of fear of shame. It not only provokes a sense of shame when in the wrong, but of guilt and remorse. Look at what is happening in our country. Do people feel shame? Do the thugs who steal money for HIV repent? Do they feel sorry? Do they feel wrong? Do the pastors who call their desperate parishioners of all their wealth and they become rich, do they feel shame? Do the policemen who go to the streets to arrest prostitutes and then get them off the street and have sexual intercourse with them have shame? You are selling your body, but I want to have sex. Now you can go. Do they feel shame? Where is the conscience? Even where no witness or incriminating evidence exists, the conscience compels the wrongdoer to confess and or make amends. When the conscience is seared, people can have sex here. You who feels ashamed, you turn your eyes away. I'm talking about the conscience of a Ugandan, the conscience of an African. Can tough laws address the moral challenge that we have as a nation, as a country, as a continent? Yes, yes. Even where witnesses and evidence exist, the same whose conscience is dead or seared will deny or bribe his or her way out. What are we seeing? We are seeing police officers, we are seeing people in the judiciary becoming wealthy, becoming huge, becoming fat because of the bribes they take, and they let the criminals off the hook. You can have laws or no laws, they'll simply become a formality. Life conscience dictates that good and right must be done whether laws exist or not. Dead conscience dictates what I want must be done, even if it means law breaking. Uganda is about 80% Christian in different faith, 15% Muslims, 5% traditionalist. One way or another, traditionalist means they go with the, what we call the traditional moral values. The 80% go with what we call the biblical moral values, and the 15% the Quranic moral values. Why is it that we have all of this rot? We have a high rate of corruption, a high rate of human sacrifice. The question is, we want all these laws, but where is God in the African lives who have become Christians, who have become Muslims? And where are the values that used to hold the Ugandan, the Africans, the Munyoro, the Muganda, the Muchika together, that this is right, this is wrong? If those values are no longer treasured, can these laws help us? For laws to be effective, people must be aware of them and the consequences of breach and are ready to obey them. Nicholas Opio, you know, do our people know the laws? They don't know them. I've told many lawyers, why don't you set up a campaign to educate people about the laws that we have? We've already had the pornography law on the penal code, section 166 of the penal code. Before this one was brought, there was that law. And the sentences, if only enforced, were sufficient enough to at least cause sanity. But they are not. And look at this. Even after the enactment of the Anti Pornography Bill, now law, you watch the TVs, isn't pornography being relayed on TV? Switch on your TV after 11. p.m. and you see women dancing naked, and this is pro. And
you also see them, Pastor.
I'm a leader.
You also see them.
Listen to me. To be able to lead people, you must be knowledgeable. You must be conversant. How will you address a problem?
But that why am I asking you that? You said you have just earlier accused the Bukede of showing such.
I'm a researcher. Researchers go into each other from the area.
You are doing a research based on Bukede TV.
To address not only Bukede.
Exactly.
And there are papers on the streets where women are naked.
All those platforms are giving you a platform on which you can do your research and therefore come here and be able to preach.
No. Yeah. I'm not even preaching. I'm not preaching, incidentally. I'm just informing you. Listen, the system is supposed to enforce them to ensure justice and redress. Wait, I'm winding up. For laws to be effective, the system is supposed to enforce them to ensure justice and redress to the heart. The police, DPP, and judiciary must be ethical, must be professional, must be efficient, must be effective, so that people have confidence in them. Now, where are we? There must be unnecessary interference to cause miscarriage of justice. Uganda has a problem of order from above. Order from above has directed many proceedings in court. I've had cases where order from above directs and the case is closed. Order from above directs and the case turns against the complainant. Order from above. Order from above in this country is far more powerful than even the laws and the law enforcing structures. Justice must be for all and not selective. What we see today is justice for the privileged few. When there is no effectiveness in effecting justice, in effecting justice and redress, people lose trust in the justice process, while habitual wrongdoers take charge of the systems. When such happens, one, victims feel reluctant to pursue justice and redress through the systems. Two, breaking the law with impunity increases. It's what we see today. Organized crime stroke mafia increases, and we continue seeing that even big men like Bukenya and so on are all crying mafia. Laws become useless tools. He who has money, power, connections, order from above, etc., dictates the justice. You remember the Katoka Jubi case? One justice cleared him. The second justice, that is the current DPP, condemned him and imprisoned him on the very same facts. No additional evidence was adduced to have him convicted. What was that?
Now,
let me jump a lot. Let us look at this. This is what we now need to do. Laws or no laws, this is what we need. We need to overhaul the Directorate of Public Prosecutions so that it can be effective. Many people are crying of injustice because of the justice system. And the parliament is enacting laws, including this one, the Anti Pornography Will, allegedly to put right morality, to safeguard culture, to safeguard cultural values, when the systems are themselves rotten. The judiciary needs an overhaul so that a law is a law and it doesn't discriminate. Thirdly, we have what we call the Ministry of Ethics and Integrity. It needs to work with moralists to define important moral values so that they can be inculcated into our young people. We have many adults today who don't fear the law. Their brains have been corrupted. Their minds have been corrupted. They want nakedness. They want to walk naked. They want to have sex when people are listening. Even on musicals, you know musicals. A woman who has been imported will make all the noise so that the neighbors and the young people outside there know that she is having sex inside a bachelor's home. All this is happening. So, listen. There must be the will on the part of the system to enforce the laws and deliver justice. Note, and let me tell you this. In 1970, President Idi Amin Dada interpreted the Penal Code, Section 166, and declared an end to mini dresses. People complied because the system was biting. And a woman would be told, you bend. When she bends and the thighs appear, she's whipped and detained. And people stopped putting on minis. That was the time that maxis were introduced. And our women were looking for so beautiful. But today, the law was enacted and the women are still dressing seductively. Let me tell you this. No law is going to tap and control the inner man of a person where we have what we call impunity. It's my right. I can dress as I want. If that is what the person believes, and that is the bottom of the conscience, then no law can tap into that. That's why people kill even when there are tough laws against murder.
And on that very point,
the laws are not going to move right our culture. We need to go back to the...
Olaf said, a gentleman who traveled from Nigeria 2 days ago to attend this debate. Let me introduce to you a Nigerian man called Mr. Justice Akili. Mr. Justice Akili.
Good evening, all. I have been introduced. I'm Akili, White Justice. That justice is my slave name, by the way. I would love you to address me as Mr. Akili. This topic is very delicate and very serious. Our three speakers have spoken very, very well, and I congratulate them for that. But I'm of the opinion that despite everything that has happened or we are going on, is going on, or we are passing through, I still challenge we Africans that we still need law to guide us. One, briefly before I defend my point I just said a second ago, I will agree with my fellow speakers that yes, this law is not being implemented, it's being passed and it's not being implemented, and there are so many things contradicting it, and so on and so forth. One, the number one thing that has killed Africans today, and as I'm speaking to you, is the judiciary. The judiciary has killed us to the without a limit, because out of a country of 174 million people, that is Nigeria, we have 103 people that sit and determines what happens to the 174 million. It has killed us because in my state, where I come from Benue State, that is the North Central, the governor of my state was from PDP, and the opponent party came so strong that took him unaware, and the opponent won the election. But what did he do? He said he has the power. He will announce himself as the governor, and let's settle it in court. That was what he said. For the past 3 years, they chased the case in court, and the young man still won because he had money. He was using the resources of the state to finance his judgment. I was on the same opinion with you, yes. But we need these laws. No matter how our leaders have been demonized, no matter how our leaders have been brainwashed, and why did I make such statement? We are Africans. And we are suffering hundreds of years ago due to what happened to us. We are still suffering it even till date. Why did I say we are still suffering and what happened? I will take you back to slavery for just a minute. There were three forms of slavery. One was human resource. The next one most of us are aware about the Berlin Conference in Germany, that was natural resources. And this modern slavery that is taking place right now is the extermination of all the African people, you and me, on earth. The reason is very long. Of course, if you want to know the reason, it will be my personal discussion with you. Now, if we need to have a concept of what happened and how we came to be here, and why am I taking you back to history? I'm taking you back to history because everything that has happened to us and everything that we are experiencing now was under a process. And that process has gone hundreds, thousands of years that we are in this generation now, and you and I feel that anything we are doing is good. Let me challenge you, Africans, that we have a culture. We have a culture, and we were stripped from that culture. That now you might think or you see that what a fellow sister, what a fellow brother is doing is a choice. It's not a choice. Our forefathers never practiced that. The reason why I said no matter how the judiciary, no matter how the government is corrupt, by them implementing laws but not acting, trying to enforce it on you and me, is yes, they are there and they are not, they have been implemented and they are not being forced to us, and even though they have been forced, we can still obey it because of this, our education system and our religion. The education system have killed us and our religion have killed us. Those are the two reasons. Now, the number one thing I'm centralizing on, that no matter how this government or these laws are, that we don't need them, that I'm telling you that we need them, is just one thing, which is the homosexuality law that have been roaming about Africa. If anybody in this hall stand up now and tell me that we don't have a culture, if anybody in this law stand up and tell me that law or what is happening about the homosexuality being the order of the day is a choice, then I will tell that person in this hall that he or she don't have a culture. Because our culture never taught us to bend down for another man. These white folks brought these things to us. So if you tell me right now that if there are no laws, then we should accept anything that comes to us. We should accept the GMOs. We should accept the same-sex marriage because we don't have a culture. Sorry, because we don't have laws to safeguard us. Is that who you are? Is that who your father was? Is that who your ancestors was? Was that what they were practicing? Because we have been what? Dehumanized. And we have been Christianized. And we are in a modern world. We are in a global village. So anything can go. Anything can go for it. I challenge Africans today that we have a culture and we have to respect that culture.
Information.
Find the information. Yes.
Thank you.
If you don't have a culture in your country or elsewhere where you've been moving around the world, in Uganda or somewhere or other parts in Uganda have courage and they respect that. And there is choice of everything, trust me that. When you're saying like, I want a person in this room to wake up or stand up to say, like homosexual, if I'm gay, it's my choice. Truly it's my choice because no one is gonna force me. And there's no one is going to force me or maybe coerce me. It's not about maybe money or any other reason, but I have a reason, you get. So I don't want you to stop saying that, and then Another information I would like to talk to you is stop being racist.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to inform the current speaker that the African culture, you are the current speaker, the African culture says we, not I, to the extent that if you are doing something that contravenes the we, you are perceived to be a wrong character. So the argument of we precedes the I. So you may have your own personal freedom, but as long as it jeopardizes the common good, society will condemn you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's give the microphone to him.
Very much. Man, I'm a fellow African. I guess you are a lawyer.
No, I'm not yet.
You are not yet, but you are practicing law. That is what is killing you and me. The education system. You told me that your religion accepts, your religion says that homosexuality is a choice. Do you know, if you are a Christian, do you know what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah? If you tell me that you are an African, you have a culture, do your culture accept that same-sex marriage?
I was not saying like it's a religion or like I believe in or my faith like is promoting that. But I say it. Truly, believe me or not, this is being true and being realistic in life. Everyone has got that kind of chance of doing he or she feels is the best for him or her. Whether you believe or not. So if we argue like because you're an African, you're going to be strict, you're going to be rigid on your culture, I don't care. But people are going to do what they feel is right for
now,
them.
Now, I want to inform my brother, if at all, if a society, let's leave alone the current laws, but let's talk about customs. If a society believes in any custom or norm, you cannot do without that custom and live in such a custom. So if we are letting Africa and laws, you cannot tell us that because you are an African, you will do it what Africans believe in because you are an individual.
You are raising
information to Mr. Akile.
Okay.
Mr. Akile deceived us that actually homosexuality was brought to Africa by the whites.
Yes.
Mr. Akile, you haven't been reading history. Yes. I'll let me inform you. There is people have tried to do research and determine where these customs came from. Now, apparently in 1640s, a Dutch came to Africa in a kingdom called Bundu. He was surprised to find that in that kingdom there was a woman who ruled as a king. And this woman had wives, had women he was using as wives. And how can you start saying that it is the whites who brought homosexuality to Africa? Who taught Kabaka Manga homosexuality?
You made that fight for. I want someone. What is it?
I'm disappointed with the current speaker. And I'm not surprised because he said history. That is his story, the white man's story. If you knew your story that was behind 1482, before the Dutchman stepped in this land, then you wouldn't be speaking like that. When the white man came here, that's when he came with all these barbaric manners. I'm not being racist, I'm being realistic. And that's how people know. So, he's talking about 16. 16 is so recent. You see, that is when we were already brainwashed. We were already taken away from civilization into barbarism. And I would like to refer him to our stories from 1482 backwards to BC and AD. When we
Africa needs stronger laws to safeguard its rules and culture. That is the topic. Let's go ahead.
Law, or to complement, to say a little on that homosexuality, I was just making a point. I was making a point and I will still repeat myself. I said if we don't have laws, we have culture and we have to respect the laws in as much as it is corrupt. The judiciaries are corrupt. We need these laws because if we don't need the laws, this was where I said you accept homosexuality and say it's a choice, you accept GMOs and say it's a choice.
I was just making a point. No matter what happens, we still need these laws. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mr. Akire Justice from Nigeria.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Thank you very much, all the discussants. I'm really so glad to be here. Actually, when I was told about this topic, I felt very happy. I felt like it came in the right time. Mr. Kato, when you were giving your first presentation, I was so touched. But as well, I was so worried about what actually you brought up.
You told me you were disappointed. Don't sugarcoat things.
I was so worried where we're going. And when I was sitting there, I have a bunch of papers that I've been collecting from different schools. I got addicted to pornography at the age of 13. And when I got addicted to pornography at the age of 13, my addiction grew up to when I was 27. Right now I'm 28. So that means a year back. That's when the addiction broke up. Now, the first time I watched pornography was at the neighborhood when someone bought a blue movie. And then this VHS cassette, we watched it, three people in the room. And when we watched it, three people in the room, three guys in the room, we brought another one and brought another one and brought another one. By then I was in Mdiango. Why am I bringing up my past? Because you cannot, Nicholas spoke it up very well. These laws cannot indeed fight pornography. But as well, we need them to show the benchmark of where we are. As a society, it's not the law that is going to keep me out of pornography. Because last year, I was one of the people who were fighting this law, like you, Mr. Kato. I was fighting the law. Because by then, I was getting a lot of money from pornography. I used to sell girls. I had an escort service, and it was the best in the whole of Uganda. And also, I used to organize OG nights for that. So I used to promote my events online, and no policymaker could even handle me. It's the conscience that you mentioned that says that in our society we don't do this. No, in our society we do not sell women for money. The law cannot really bring pornography indeed, because how can someone enact a law when he or she is addicted to pornography? How can they? How can someone enact the law in these schools when they also enjoy pornography? I've been moving in schools. I have a bunch of papers there. Kids saying that, you know, I'm dying because this is not what I am. This is not who I am. They're dying and they're writing papers. I've been moving and I'm still moving in schools. And in fact, we have a summit that is going on. And next week, we're going to start the White Ribbon campaign against pornography. And why are we saying all that? Because when I keep on moving in these schools or in these institutions or on radio stations or what, I keep on telling that, like this gentleman said, that, you know, we have a choice. You have a choice to watch porn. It's your choice. That's why I will not come to you and tell you to stop watching porn. But then I'm just worried about the next generation. So when I go to schools, I don't tell kids that, hey, porn is bad, porn is bad. No, I don't tell them that, because if it's bad, why do they enjoy it? I tell them that the reason as to why you don't pass your exams is because your head is filled with junk, and that junk is porn. And porn is not what Mr. Rumba, the porn that you're talking about, oh, Pastor Malay, the porn that you watched 20 years back, or the porn that I watched 13 years back, is not the porn that is on TV right now, or which is being sold. The porn that is being sold on YouTube, X videos, RedTube, and blah blah blah, is actually not porn. It's more than porn. It's one guy with four girls. It's two girls with one guy. And now this one is doing the mouth, and then this one is doing the ass. This one is doing the vagina, and this one is doing the other way around. So that's actually beyond porn. When I tell kids, I don't tell them that that's sex. That's not sex, because sex is defined between man and woman. Now this is man and women. So it's more than that. It's defining what we actually define as sex. So I don't tell them that, hey, stop watching porn, blah, blah, blah. No, no. I tell them the reality is that when I started watching porn, my grades declined from 90 to 70 to 40 to 02, up to the time I failed that class. But when I stopped watching porn, I became sober again. So we need to change the way we approach issues. And we need to start right now, people. You have a right to do whatever you have to do, whatever you do, because you're old enough. And I'll never tell you to stop watching porn. But I only want you to save the next generation. I really want to thank you very much. I want to give this one to Pastor Malin as and then my second book, which followed, Who Turned Our Good African Women into Prostitutes. That actually is for the human rights activists. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Geoffrey. Ladies and gentlemen, I couldn't tell him but allow him to finish because he has been my friend. He's one.
My name is Lisa. I'm a student at LDC. Now, we are asking ourselves, do we really need laws to protect our African culture? I've realized that we have all centered on one thing, pornography, how we dress. What happened to other norms that people in Africa use it to practice? Maybe we need the laws, but which kind of laws do we need? Do we need the anti-pornography bill? Do we need to be told that if you put on a short skirt, you are practicing pornography or you're exhibiting pornography? What happens to the Karamajongo woman whose culture is to cover only the breasts and maybe some small part here and the other parts are open? What happens to them? Are we protecting their culture with our laws? What happens to Swahili women if we are saying in Africa we have our culture?
What happens
to the Swahili women whose culture is to go about with their breasts?
I mean, expose it.
Maybe we need the laws, but which kind of laws? If today we are bringing laws to say, okay, everyone should go back to their culture, and Uganda should put on a kanzu.
Thank the information. Yes, let him inform us.
That the Karamojong woman, that what happened to the Karamojong woman, who covers the breast and leaves them. But is it true that the Karamojong woman covers only the breast and leaves that part?
If you do not know your culture, I'm sorry, I will not apologize. But if you go back and ask your forefathers before the introduction of these suits we are putting on, before the introduction of the mini skirts, what were they putting on?
I mean, even now,
people still dress according to how their culture dictates. In some countries where their culture has not been defiled, for us, we are here discussing laws which are defiling our cultures more. We are saying you should not put on a mini skirt.
Why aren't you saying
that you put on a gomez since it is your culture and you're bringing that law to emphasize and
protect the culture of a Muganda woman?
We need the laws. But maybe even our legislators should be taken back to the cultural institutions to be educated about what culture means. Maybe they don't know. Actually, when they were beginning, when Mr. Kato was here explaining, I got an impression, I said, we don't need the laws. But then later I started thinking, what comprises culture? The way people behave, the way people put on, and what we are legislating now is not culture. We are actually legislating
an important culture. And the laws that are coming are to protect that culture that we imported from God knows where. I'm saying yes, only the laws.
But the laws
should be directed to protecting the culture that can be traced way back before the introduction or before the intrusion of this other culture that we are trying to protect.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much.
My thought is that morals have to enforce myself. If you want to protect morals, you shouldn't look at enforcing them. You should look at teaching society the good that is in those morals. Because when you try to enforce them, in fact, I shouldn't forget my brother Geoffrey. Because Geoffrey might think he's doing this country a service, but he's doing it a disservice. Why? There are very many kids out there in primary school who have never heard the word porn, who have never come across pornography. So when he goes to a school and starts speaking about pornography, he is introducing them to a topic some of them have never heard about. And you know, the young
so how is he going to address those that are already addicted? And how is he going to isolate that? These ones know, these ones don't know.
Look here. The young mind is curious. When you tell it something it has never come across, then they are going to seek it out. That is my fear. I don't know how it's going to do it, because I don't know how it's going to differentiate between those who have come across it and those who haven't yet. But I know there are very many out there in school. And even those who have come across it, they are going to do it in hiding. So, Mr. Chairman, for me, my take is, actually, when I was coming here, I told Council Nicholas, when he posted on Facebook, I told him, you're going to go to a forum, and you're going to find people whose thinking is driven by white phobia, who think that every African problem is the cause of a white man. And that is very dangerous. Why? In very many instances, we are fearing shadows. For instance, we are here, everyone has been here, my brother Justice, and many of our friends here, claiming African culture. And they are sounding like those white men out there who think Africa is one huge country. Africa has never been one huge country. Africa is a collection of very many cultures. And some of those cultures actually even clash. So when you say African culture, what is African culture? What is African culture? The Karamanjot is comfortable going around naked. Well, for the Baganda or some other cultures.
Mr. Chairman, whereas the Karamanjot move half naked, their moral values are very strong. Actually, would you see a Karamanjot man going to sleep with a lady? They have strong values deeply ingrained in their minds and hearts not to engage in any sexual promiscuity. And besides that, it is a universal cultural norm across African cultures where same-sex relations were not given room. It was unacceptable. Give me an example. Within the so many African countries where homosexuality or any sexual engagement was permitted. Which culture is that?
My brother Ula, I would want to inform you that while you were saying the Karamanjot they hold their values and they're into promiscuity, my point was that we as Africans are a conglomeration of very many cultures, not a single culture. Actually, if you know it, among the Karamanjot, you just don't go and sweet talk a lady, you have to rape her in courts. You go and do your research. If you don't wrestle her to the ground and win her, you just don't sweet talk her and you think you'll put her on the bed. So that is how diverse African culture is. Now, do we also need a legislation on that? Mr. Chairman, the law mentions child pornography. In fact, no one here has spoken about child pornography. That is why this feels very dangerous. If some of you know,
Some of the best pictures of kids are kids who are naked, showing, it shows innocence, the age of innocence. Now, since the law says anything to do with nudity is pornography, I've seen very many guys who are posting pictures of girls nude, dirty kids, you know, out there in the villages. Now, should they be charged with pornography? That is how big this law is. Internet service providers are companies like Orange, MTN, Broadband. I want to talk about liberties because it is a question disturbing us here. Liberties. Does someone have the liberty to be homo? Does someone have the liberty to wear like someone likes? You know, liberty and freedom is about you having your freedom just as long as it doesn't interfere in another person's freedom. Now, I'm asking, if there are two men locked up in some room somewhere doing their stuff, how does it affect me? How does it affect me? It's up to them. I don't know if a woman is putting on a short dress, because even all women here, our libido is different. So, because there are even people who see someone wearing a long skirt, but when you see the buttocks protruding and then your man starts, so, you know, these laws just don't make any sense. For me, what I say is, if you want to ensure Amaros are going, we can, Africans used to outcast people. You know what they call an outcast? Yeah? That you're not welcome in our society. But we don't say that we ban you, it's criminal. Yeah? We can discriminate against you in our occasions, our ceremonies. But we can't say that it's criminal for you to be this.
Yeah, I'll be precise and brief like a mini skirt. Because the motion says, Africa needs strong laws to strengthen its norms and customs. Yeah, according to me, laws should remain and even culture and norms remain. The only point is this, doing the right thing. And what's the right thing?
Thank you so much. Let me end up from the audience with Mr. Longole John Bosco. African needs strong laws to safeguard African culture and values. For me, there's no way of establishing again some laws. And yet, the laws in Uganda, or which are in the constitution of Uganda, they have not implemented. These laws which are being established, they are just a business way or a business way of life. For example, laws are being established to benefit the rulers, judges, and police. In this, you find that someone is murdered or has killed somebody when evidence is very clear. So when you go and say, now someone has been murdered, then they say they are still under investigation. When you are saying the thing physically, what are you investigating? That's so true. That investigation, they are just bargaining on how much are we going to pay or how much are you going to pay to the judiciary or the police to release you from being arrested. And therefore, I disagree that there are no way of again forming laws. And if you are establishing laws in Uganda or in Africa, just modernize the original laws. Because Africans are weak to follow these transferred laws from the Western life.
This opportunity, I'm Baguma Robert. And I really oppose the motion because of the following reasons. Yes, I'll be straightforward. Because at the end of it, if you're proposing or opposing, I think when you come here, just give your views. If you're proposing, suggest the motion. And if you're not if you're opposing, then nullify the motion in your view. So me, what I'm saying is, it's not the problem of you stopping or forming, again, new laws about pornography, but it's all about doing other things. For example, a being about religion. We have to believe, like in Africa, right now we have a weakness of faith. Eh? So at the end of it, you find a person, he has that kind of faith, he believes in born again, he's a Christian, and then at the end of it, he has that kind of, the other way around, of has to go to shrines. So, I mean, it's all about we increasing our faith and increasing, how can we do it? It's all about our pastors, and then pastors should always have to be really strict and really be a little bit hurry in the way how they are supposed to preach this kind of work. Don't preach for the case of benefits, and don't preach for the case of wealth.
Let me have Mr. Peter Ogwa.
Good evening.
I'm here to correct a few mistakes and to give my view on the one. One, Africans not being welcoming, that is wrong. Africa has always been welcoming. That is why we even went through the Holocaust, because of our kind hearts. The second one, African culture not being modern, that is wrong. African culture was modern and we had culture, that is why we civilized even before the white man came into being. So, whatever we have discussed here from the pastor, believe it or not, it all rotates under culture. These are all components of culture. Religion, behavior, anything is under culture. So if we do not go ahead with our culture. Culture, when we talk about culture, we're talking about, we are facing and we are going towards subconscious and the conscious part of humanity. So if you do not address culture, how do you expect to address moral values in society? It is true, some of our friends in Africa used to walk half naked, but because of the culture, they were morally upright, and we had no temptations to do anything out of society. So, we may be having over 32 cultures in Uganda. That is not a problem. Give them a chance and let whoever is responsible help build strong cultural norms and values. Because I would have changed the topic so that Africa needs culture, strong culture norms, to make our laws strong. Because if we have the strong culture norms, then the laws can stand. But you will not bring laws and expect me to follow your laws when at home I'm not taught. Charity begins from home. So when we're talking about culture, we're looking at society, and when we're looking at society, we go back to the smallest unit of society, which is a family. So if you're not educated from your family, from the start, through the African values and norms, then there is no one outside of your family that is going to take you into straight being and will teach you the discipline that you need in society. However, we need the laws, because we're living in an evil society, and this being, we are human, and there's no society that can live without our laws and restrictions and regulations, because we're human beings, and human beings need laws to be kept in line. But the one most and most powerful point is culture. That is what differentiated us from the white man who is barbaric, because of our good cultures. Thank you very much.
And on that point, ladies and gentlemen, allow me introduce a man from Chankwanzi National Leadership Institute, a man who has lectured even his master. He comes and lectures his master. After lectures, the master again comes back and masters him. Professor Tatema Kokarusoke is a columnist in the New Vision, a very hardcore when it comes to Pan-Africanism. And I would like also to give him a very big round of applause, because he's a pioneer member of this club. He was here on the very first day this club began. Professor Katabako.
Thank you, comrade. What is culture? You see, there is nothing like society or nature being static. Everything in either nature or society is undergoing motion. The law of motion is universal. You can't remain the same since you were born. Right now as you are, you'll find it is becoming 12, 1, the sun will appear when you are seated here. Why? Because the earth is moving around its axis. And when you find light has changed its position, it's because you are undergoing relative motion. There's motion everywhere. We are undergoing relative motion now. If we stay here up to 7 in the morning, we shall find the sun is in another position. That's relative motion. Right now, new cells in your bodies are superseding old ones. You see, right now, new geological layers are superseding the old layers underneath the crust of the earth. There's motion everywhere, and new classes in society are superseding old ones, and new generations are superseding old generations. The world, the whole world, both in nature and society, is subject to motion. So when you are talking about culture, within the context of it being static or preserving what you had before, you are just qualified as a fulminating demagogue. There's not such a thing as static culture. Did your father drive a car? Did your grandfather drive a car? No. Did your ancestor enjoy electricity as culture? No. Imagine religion. Religion is in three parts: idol worship, polytheism, now monotheism. When your technology was inferior, you would imagine the three impersonated spirit, you worshipped it. When technology went up, you cut the tree, you infiltrated the mountain, you developed a canoe, you conquered the sea, you stopped worshipping them. Idol worship was destroyed. Under technological advancement and changes in mental consciousness and the spiritual makeup, how are you spiritually made up? According to modern technology. Now, there comes a polytheism. You have discovered what is in the moon because there was a god of the moon.
So what I try to say by saying we should continue and carry on with our culture, I'll start with giving examples of the Asian countries. These people never let go of their culture. They embrace modernity, but let it be embedded into your culture. Accept the motion, but do not move out of line. That is what I was trying to say. I'm not saying if you used to use canoes, continue using canoes. No. Yep.
They are enjoying infrastructure, which is modern from European countries, which developed technology higher than them. Even India was a colony of Britain. That's why they are driving cars. Cars was not a culture of Indians. This is a culture of the British who ruled them. When colonialism in India was a high stage of capitalism by Britain, conquering India and ruling India, where India now is exercising what they inherited from British capitalism at its high stage of colonialism. When Mahatma Gandhi said, the only thing you can say is they should not own our assets. They should not own land. Yeah. It is only the issue of ownership.
Yeah.
But not infrastructure. You are all putting on ties. Is that the culture of your ancestors?
No.
You're hopeless. You see, you're all using bottles instead of gourds. You see, is that your culture? You are driving cars. You see, don't base culture on race.
Yeah.
Don't base culture on emotions.
Yeah.
You should base culture on standards of technological advancement. Who owns, the most important thing is who owns means of production. Because it is the economic system in any socio-economic formation which determines culture. Slave owning. Was it correct to own slaves? Greeks and Romans were wrong to own slaves as masters. And they talk about democracy. And yet, under democracy and the Greeks, when you talk about retain rule and demos people, women and slaves are not allowed to discuss what happens in society. Is that democracy? People is relative. Because people means only the masters, the rulers. You see, you now, colonists thought you were not people. Same thing, people is relative. So now when we're talking about culture, we should think about what sort, and I'm very serious in this, every society in the universe is determined by what type of economic system you apply to determine culture. And that will depend also on technology and science. And when I talk about economic system, who owns land, who owns the means of production, that's culture. So culture is not static. You should look at culture from the point of view of the economic system, which determines your being, whereby who owns the means of production, what type of technology is there, production, will determine spiritual life. Then spiritual life, as a component of superstructure, put together with economic base, will put in place a socio-economic formation. Now you should use art, drama, music, sculpture, drawing, painting, cinema, TV, to shape spiritual life according to what type of economic system you are using, to accept how that economic system can be of use to all people, not just individuals who own private means of production, those who privately own factories, mines, and what. No, you should make a difference between education and training. That's when we can have culture in a proper form. Then the economic system, slave owners were not correct. Tenants, now you have my land here. All those having my land and collecting rent from tenants are not educated. They are all stupid people, hopeless, and my land should be abolished, not tomorrow, but tonight by 12. Yes, I'm telling you, anybody owning my land here is just an agent of colonialism. You see how you can change? Somebody can become an agent of, because Maryland, your land belongs to Uganda. But when the Europeans came, they gave it to kings, turning them into prefects of economic exploitation above their people and against their own people, worshipping colonialists. So any descendant of those kings retaining Maryland is in the footsteps of colonialists and is a vampire. Any prince or so-called descendant of a Kabaka is a vampire. Now I'm declaring all those who have my land are vampires against Ugandans, no matter which tribe. With culture, don't pay attention to tribe or ethnic groups or anything. Now you are worshipping God. Have you ever seen God? It's an imagination. Technology has gone so up that you can't even see God in lakes, in mountains, or what. This is an imagination that there is God. When you are maximizing your lunacy, you think there is God, you begin kneeling, and as you kneel in churches, you come out like that, qualified lunatics, you fools, stupid, as you go to church. And in mosques with their kettles and sandals, they come out like that. Allah, 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 Ya Muhammad al-Rasul. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh rahman al-Rahim. Inshallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Stupid. One of them. They go there as they are, come out nothing. And for you also, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, thy will be done on earth as it is in earth. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive them that trespass against us. You are hopeless. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, the Father of Jesus Christ, who was born by Virgin Mary, suffered and Pontius Pilate, crucified, dead and buried, resurrected the third day, and third day he rose again from the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost. How can you believe in a ghost even if it is holy? Stupid. How can you believe in the Holy Ghost? However hard it is, how can you believe in the Ghost? Are you hearing nothing? I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Can the body resurrect when it is undergoing humors? Stupid. Now, I think I'm liberating you from irreversible lunacy. Don't be a lunatic anymore. Because you have been a fool, stupid. And now you can see some of these campaigners are going to church giving them gifts. What for? Religion can't organize society because it is a fantasy. Religion is a fantasy. Baba has given money to churches. Seven has given money to churches. What for? Churches, unless church preaches spiritual life in connection with a given economic system which is in favor of the people, the churches are symbols of fantasy. And all clergymen are stupid and fulminating demagogues. I'm talking. And even God, when God comes here, he should be slapped for creating people like that one. And I have defended state in my historical theories that the state is an apparatus in the hands of a ruling class to reflect the economic law, the economic will of the ruling class, to implement that will and to suppress the will of those considered incorrect in the running of the state, according to the economic intentions of the ruling class. And law is the sum total of compulsory and obligatory standards of behavior and conduct acceptable only to the ruling class, which thinks their laws are correct above those of the ruling classes. You see, that's what it is.
Mr. Justice Akiri, in one
march, my fellow brother, they have said everything. We need laws to safeguard our culture. We need laws that we look up to so as for the betterment of our society tomorrow.
Mr. Justice,
let's stop receiving these forces from the whites. Thank you.
Professor seems to believe in nothing, yet he's obsessed by the self and Marxism. He's also a brainwasher. Finally. Even someone who does not believe in God believes in something.
What do you mean by Marxism? Can you define?
I'm not going to define that because I never came to discuss politics or what. We have good laws already, but the laws are not working. Why are the laws not working? The problem is not the laws, but it's the conscience of the Africans, of the Ugandans, which has been killed, which is seared. That tough laws, however tough, will be broken. Now, what we need is to get back to the roots. Define where we want to go. Define the values that we cherish as a people, as Ugandans, as Baganda, as Banyankole, as Banyoro, as Africans, if you want to put it in the wider context, and the best way forward for our people.
Because thank you very much. My conclusion is simple. We don't need the anti-pornography law, because it is redundant, uncalled for, and unnecessary. We don't need any law that is going to promote discrimination against women, that is going to violate people's rights, privacy, and freedom to associate and assemble. So, in brief, we are simply saying, we don't need any law to tell us what to dress, to tell us how to move with our private lives. We need a law that can be fair to all, men and women, tall, black, short, brown, and I want to thank the professor for the line of argument he has presented that was bordering on Marxism and atheism. To me, he had a point. We should pick a leaf somehow from the ones he has shared with us and move as a country that respects others, leaving others to live and letting others to struggle and survive.
I
Thank you very much.
I do not. Very good. 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 Very good.